we're going to harvest some of the vegetables because this is the end of the season. The end of the season is a really funky time of year. The garden is starting to wind down, and some of the insects that we didn't notice earlier are starting to come in force, and it seems like it's like a wave. Grasshoppers will come in at the end of the season. Spider mites are really rabid towards the end of the season, and there's a reason for that. The reason is that around here at least, the reason is that this is the drier season. We don't have as much rain, and so it's dry, it's hot. Your plants have gone full tilt for a long time, and they're also tired. They've already produced their stuff, and they're starting to wane, starting to slow down. And that's when the insects come in and attack your plants. Insects love an unhealthy plant. They will attack. It's just like in nature. You get the lions, they go after the weakest of the herd. Same thing with insects and stuff. If you have a really healthy, well-growing plant, generally, it fights off the insects and the diseases a lot easier. When you have a weaker plant, it doesn't do so well. And spider mites, for some reason, they know when to find a weaker plant. And that's what's happening to some of my plants. Spider mites moved in practically overnight. And so yeah, they're starting to attack things. Now, there's an easy way to treat those. You can get pyrethrin, you can get nicotine sulfate spray, you can get a lot of things to kill spider mites. Thing is, if you don't get every single mite, they will come back in force in just a few more days. They are amazing at just coming in because they come in off the wind. And so you could totally clear your whole garden of every little bug. But all it takes is one gentle breeze or one bird to land in your garden and you have spider mites again. So it's one of those things where, for me, I could spend all of my time fighting them off, or I could just harvest my stuff, let them do what they want to do, and I'm out of here. I don't have to deal with those little boogers. And I hate spider mites. And the less I have contact with them, the less chance I have of taking them inside with me on my clothes, on my hands, on my dog, and taking them into the voodoo garden inside. Once spider mites get inside, it is a fight for life in there. It's a life and death struggle. And I lost last year, so I'm very, very respectful of an insect that's been around for a long time. Anyway, enough of those insects. I'm going to show you some of the plants that I'm harvesting today, and I'm going to show you, I don't know where I was going with that. Let's just harvest some plants and shut me up, okay? Come on over here, let's start with the cabbage. As far as harvesting, there's easy ways or difficult ways. I don't have any system. Come on. I just pull the leaves back and I have me a nice little head of cabbage. Yep. I'm going to steam this up tonight. That's going to be absolutely delicious. Oh, son of a gun. Now when you pull these leaves back, sometimes you're going to notice that there's these little dots in here. You know what that is? You know what that is? That is worm poop. Yep. Cabbage worms. Cabbage worms love cabbage, and they will get in there and eat it. Now, what I like to do with cabbage, oh wow, take a look at that. Nice root system, worms are down there. They're having a good time. Now, what I like to do when I harvest my cabbage, I don't just take this out and throw it in the compost bin. What I do until fall, and it's quite a ways till fall, I like to just take this and throw the leaves down onto the bed. And the reason that I do this is because it encourages the worms to come up and the other insects that live in the soil. They will come up and just start munching this up, turning it into poo and turning it into good stuff for the soil. This basically biodegrades down and goes right back into your soil. Yep, I don't have to deal with composting this. Ooh, another head of cabbage. Well, okay, you talked me into it. I'll take that one too. Hey, it's small, but it's edible. These are the ugliest cucumber plants you will see in your life. Yes, my plants are uglier than yours, so take that. These were my beautiful cucumber plants early in the season. And for me, cucumbers tend to do well in a cooler season. For some reason, when it gets hot, they tend to get really icky. And these ones, I did my best to keep them alive. I just wanted to try. Normally, I just rip them up. But this time, I wanted to try an experiment. So what happened is, these things got really ugly. You know, they produced all kinds of good cucumbers. I was eating cucumbers as fast as I could, and I showed you, I was taking them into the chicken coop and I was holding them for the turkeys because they liked them too. So I had more than my share of cucumbers off of just two plants. It was just two seeds that grew all of these cucumbers. And these were the white wonders, and I really did like those. But the heat of the season comes on, and generally when the heat of the season comes on, your cucumbers will get bitter and or they will stop producing. And that's what happened here. They slowed down on the production. So what I did was I mixed up some compost tea, and I did nothing but water these with compost tea. And right here, you can see, up here you have the lighter leaves, and then as it put out more vines, we got darker leaves. Boy, are those dark. Yeah, they look really funky, but yep, they're actual really dark green leaves. And then they started flowering, and take a look. Yep, you would think that these were ugly dead vines, but nope, I got me a second crop, and it has been in the 90s out here. And get me some cucumbers. And that's actually pretty good. That's one of those things that if you want to try it, whenever your plants are slowing down, keep them fed, keep them watered, and just bide your time. And eventually, they may put out some more. And that's what I call a fall crop. These put out a spring crop. They went through the stress of summer, and they just kind of slowed down. Then I fed them, kept them going, and now they're full of flowers. And these half-dead looking messes are putting out fruit. Yep. See? Two. So I have two cucumbers and I have all kinds of flowers. I think I'm going to get some more, so I'm actually glad I didn't pull these up. Pretty neat. And by the way, even if these are bitter, I don't care. Turkeys love these. A nice little treat for my birds. I think it was, I don't know, a couple episodes ago, I was mentioning blight. It was on my garden failures. Yep. I had blight coming in on my Prax cherries, and that happens every year. You know, this is not something new that I was filming for you. This is something that happens every single season. Blight comes in and it takes over. Blight can be taken care of, like I've mentioned before, by mixing a level tablespoon of baking soda with a quart of water, shake it up in a spray bottle, hit the undersides of the leaves, tops, soil, stems. You can fight it back, but in the end, unless you're doing this diligently, daily almost, you're going to lose the fight to blight. But you know what I've noticed on these plants is blight will take the leaves off the lower branches, but as these other ones grow up and out of this area, they do fine. Yeah, my plants actually outgrew the blight. The blight was down there. Look it up here. Yep, I have all kinds of plant, and I have insane amounts of tomatoes coming out again. And that's another thing, is I kept the plants, just like the cucumbers over there, kept the plants fed, kept them watered, and just waited. And then after the heat of the season, they start putting out more and more flowers, more and more fruit. So I am picking tomatoes. I have a whole bunch over here that have to come out. And we have Prax cherries. And somebody asked me when I mentioned that I was going to stop carrying these, because I've grown them pretty much for, I don't know, 7-8 years or something like that. I mentioned that I was going to stop growing these because it was time to move on to something else. Holy cow. Everybody was like, no, you don't. So now they've gotten to be a little too popular, I guess. And I think I'm going to save some seeds. Actually, I know I'm going to. And I'm going to take these down to Iowa when I move next spring. And I'm going to start the Prax cherries down there. And I'm going to grow them in Iowa. But I'm going to do something different. I'm going to grow these production in Iowa with a longer season, different soil. And in my new garden, I am going to grow a bunch of these, and I'm going to do a production and save seeds and give them away in my yearly seed giveaway, because I think that it would be nice to spread these all over one more time and see how they do in a warmer environment. So, Prax cherry's not dead. It's going to continue, and it's also going to move with me to Iowa. Okay, I know what's next. Come on over here. Well, these are some sad looking plants, but with onions, you want to grow your onions. This is how I recommend that you grow onions. You can grow them any way you want. My way of growing onion is I grow them and they're big and they're green and they got the greens on top, and then they naturally fall over and start dying. Once they fall over and start dying, it's time to pick your onions. That's how I know it's time to pick my onions. And these fell over. They just did it naturally. They fell over and they're not really growing. There's not a whole lot of green left on these, so they're not really putting anything into the bulb. So it's time to pick these things up and see what's underneath the soil. I love that part. Just like potatoes, the onions are the fun ones to harvest. And I think you're gonna like what you see here. Take a look at what a Kelsey onion looks like when it grows in the Praxis garden. These beds were filled with the exact same thing as a potato bed. Leftover potting mix from inside, so you can see like the big chunks of vermiculite, and coir, which is cocoa peat, which was in the potting mix, and also compost from my compost pile. That's absolutely it. That's all that was in here, and they grew extremely well. What I did was I started these as seeds inside in little tiny plastic cups way before the growing season, like maybe a month before or something like that. And so I had these little seedlings. I planted them out here, and I might have even shown you. I just planted them out here relatively close together, and I just wanted to see if I could do it. I really had no confidence I was going to be able to grow onions, but I think I did pretty good. Let's see if I can get these out without breaking them. This, folks, is a Kelsey onion. Ooh, it's warm. It's actually warmer in the soil than it is out today. It's actually very cool out here. It's in the lower 60s. This is a Kelsey onion. Kelsey onions are grown competition, and they're a very big onion. So, you know what? I think I did pretty good. Normally, they're supposed to be bigger, but you know what? These onions are as big as anything you're going to find in the grocery store. Not bad. When I pick onions, I'm very careful. I pull them up, and then I rinse them off with the garden hose. That's all I do. I don't touch them. I just rinse them off to get the dirt off of them. Some people leave the dirt on. I prefer not to. I just rinse the dirt off, take off a few of the dead leaves, and then I take them into my basement, and I tie them together with the leaves. These are actually very tough leaves, and I'll tie them together or use a piece of string and then just hang them from my ceiling. And then when I need one, I just snip it off the stem, and I use it in my cooking. But you don't want to store these by potatoes, because if you store onions by potatoes, the potatoes will start to go bad very fast, because these let out some kind of a, is it an ethyl gas or something weird like that? I don't know. They let out some kind of a thing that's real technical that makes potatoes go bad. So you're never supposed to store your onions and potatoes close together. Tip from Ray. Beautiful, isn't it? That's a beautiful onion. Not a whole lot of root, is it? But you know, this does have more roots than you see on the plant when it comes up. It has long spidery roots that went out, but they break off when you pull it up. But that's a beautiful onion. Kelsey onions are really showstoppers when it comes to a good onion. And I didn't grow these to impress you. I just grew them because I wanted to, can't pull that one out. I wanted to see what a Kelsey onion look like, and also what it tastes like. So if it does end up looking good and tasting good, I am absolutely going to grow this year after year. And you know what I think I'm going to do? I'm going to keep one of these and plant it. Hopefully I can keep it over the winter and have it not go bad, because I would love to take this with me to the next place, grow it to seed, and save these seeds and grow it again. That would be fantastic, because this is, by the way, look at this one. This is why Kelsey onions are loved. Is that an onion? That's an onion. That's a beauty. By anybody's growing standards, that is a good-looking onion. That's a Kelsey onion. And if they taste half as good as they look, I'm going to be extremely pleased. Not a bad harvest for just a pinch of seeds. Yep, my Kelsey onions. This used to be a good-looking vine. It was growing very strong, very fast. And remember, I showed you the little watermelons on it. Yeah, it smells dead, doesn't it? Poor thing. The watermelons got big, and they were beautiful. But the problem with late season around here, and I'm sure in a lot of areas, is it puts a lot of stress on your plants because you have the heat. And we have had a lot of heat going through here. A lot of heat. This is the dry season, so they're not getting the rain that they want. And it's not just a matter of rain on the plant, on the soil. It's a matter of moisture on the plants too. Dry, hot season, that is spider mite season. And that's what happened here. Spider mites came in and they just wiped it out. They just hit almost overnight. And I came out one day to look at my plants to water them. And they had this look to them. And if you've never seen spider mites, you'll know when you got it. It's really disgusting, it's horrible, and it's really kind of sad. I could have come out here with some pyrethrin and I could have sprayed the plant, but the thing is that it was so infested so fast, and it shocked me, and it takes a lot to shock me. And this plant was so messed up that I decided, you know what, if I hit it with all these, it's not really a chemical, it's organic, but still, if you hit it with all that stuff, it's going through the stress of the heat, it's going through the stress of the spider mites, it's not going to do it any good. And your fruit is dependent on a very healthy plant. So this plant was so stressed out, so much of a mess, I decided that, you know what, I'm gonna put it out of its misery. And that's what I did yesterday. I pulled off one of the watermelons. I got a good sized watermelon. I mean, this is nothing like it's supposed to be. They're supposed to be these huge, long watermelons, but I grew two of them in a 16 inch pot, and you don't get as large a fruit generally if you grow into pots. So this was big enough. This is big enough. I opened up one yesterday and I put the picture on my Facebook, and it was delicious. It was sweet. It was juicy. It was absolutely wonderful. And it had seeds. It had regular watermelon seeds in it. I thought it was pretty cool. This is Congo. Congo is a very delicious, very sweet watermelon, and I may grow it again. Don't know. But I'm going to pick this, and then I don't know what I'm going to do with this. I don't like touching anything with spider mites because they will get onto you and go everywhere else. So as soon as I'm done filming this, I'm going to wash my hands. But like I was mentioning earlier with bugs in the garden, sometimes you just can't win, and you got to know when you can't win. And it's not a failure to call it in and throw in the towel, because sometimes you can't win against these bugs. You just got to let nature do what it does. You can't control everything. So I know when to fight my battles. I know when to back off and let nature do what it's going to do. And this is one of those instances where I'm just not going to deal with it, okay? And so you win this round, but I got the spoils.